Hey guys, it's Danny. Today we're talking about Phalaenopsis orchids, specifically their flower spikes. I'll show you how to obtain a straight Phalaenopsis flower spike, or at least as straight as possible, because if you didn't know, flower spikes of these orchids are actually pretty flexible in the first stages of their formation, so we can actually shape them, we can determine how they will grow. So today I'm going to show you how to make your life a little easier if straight flower spikes is what you want. If it's not, that's okay, don't worry about it. Now, first of all, if you're new to my channel and you just stumbled upon this video searching for care information or how to rebloom these orchids, check the description below, I'll share with you my tutorials. This is not going to refer to that. I will refer to how flower spikes grow and let's say their quirks, but if you're looking for care tutorials, do check the description. So with that said, let me get you in closer and we'll start with the beginning with a few characteristics of flower spikes. Okay, so flower spikes on Phalaenopsis orchids arise from the axis or from the stem of the plant. Phalaenopsis are monopodial orchids. They don't have a rhizome that connects multiple pseudobulbs or fans or things of the sorts. They just have a main stem that creates roots, leaves, and also flower spikes. So the spike will always come from the stem. Now in this video, we're not gonna refer to secondary spikes that arise like branches from these growth nodes, but we are only going to refer to brand new flower spikes. So as you can see, my little orchid is slanted to one direction, and this is because it is leaning towards the light source. This is a very, very typical behavior for Phalaenopsis orchids, especially when we grow them in home conditions where we have a window to the side and it's the main light source for our orchid. In nurseries, what they do is put these orchids in a sort of sleeve to maintain the leaves upward and the entire orchid upward, and we're also dealing with light from above, which helps. In the end, even if you have light from above, the orchid will start to grow sideways a little bit because in nature, these orchids would typically grow on trees like this. This shape actually helps with water just flowing on the leaves downwards and not pulling in the crown. Now, this shape of the Phalaenopsis orchid hinders a little bit the aesthetics when it comes to flower spikes because the flower spikes also tend to lean towards the light source. If it stretches to the light source, it becomes more visible to pollinators. So first and foremost, flower spikes always grow towards the light source and will try to take the route which is the brightest in their opinion. Quotation marks. Please notice that. I don't think orchids have opinions. Now let's imagine for a second that the window is my camera, and this is where the vast majority of light comes from for this orchid. The orchid will lean towards the light, it will position her foliage to be exposed to as much light as possible, but what will the flower spike do? Because the spike is somewhere hidden when it forms. It will start to grow towards the light, but the route it will take is sometimes unpredictable. Sometimes you can have the flower spike just emerging from underneath the leaves here and then taking some weird shapes in its attempt to reach the light. But as you can see in my example here, the flower spike first grew upwards and now it's kind of starting to head towards the camera. And this is because I kind of tricked it to grow that way. And everything that I will talk about today will actually revolve around the idea that flower spikes always head towards the light source. So now that we know the golden rule, let us start with the beginning, with the first sign of a flower spike. Now, since I'm filming this at the middle of December and my orchid started to spike somewhere in November, I cannot really find very, very, very tiny flower spikes, so I can show you the difference between a spike and a root, but don't worry, I have a video on it. Check it down below. You'll see there how to tell the difference between a spike and a root very early on. So in this example, I have two flower spikes. It is not uncommon. Most complex hybrids at the flower shop can actually produce two flower spikes at a time, or one, or in extreme cases, even more. But you can see that in the beginning, they will just go sideways. They will not necessarily take turns. And this is very typical for the first centimeter, and I think that would be half an inch of the flower spike's life. It is this moment when they will actually start to take a turn. So they can either go downwards or they can go upwards, depending where they think the light is brighter. If the light coming from the window shines on something here, the flower spike will believe this is the shiniest place, so it will take the downward route and then arise from between the leaves somewhere. If there is more light above the orchid, the flower spike most probably will take this route in its way towards the light. And first, we cannot use stakes, we cannot pull on the flower spike. It is not flexible, it is rigid, it is very tiny, very tender. Do not try to pull it or touch it in any way at this stage. What we're going to work with is actually light. Now here I have a flower spike which already started to take the turn. Basically what we need to provide is light that is very bright here and not here. How do we obtain this? Well, pretty easy, in two ways. First, my preferred way with a lamp, because it's very, very flexible and easy to arrange. So let me show you how I arrange the setup for pretty much most of my fowls. So this is the orchid we just saw, and you can see the flower spike is right here, and above it I have a lamp. Now right now I arranged the lamp as to make the flower spikes lean forward, but in the beginning my lamp was actually positioned much more above the orchid. It was something like this. So because the vast majority of light, or actually the strongest light, was above the orchid, the flower spike didn't feel like growing forward, but upward, because this is where the light is coming from. So the first thing you can do, even when you start seeing the flower spike, even after it's already 1 centimeter big, is to place a lamp shining above the orchid, and in this way the flower spike will actually take the upwards route, which is the beginning step in shaping the flower spike. Now the trick with the lamp is the easiest one, and it is my preferred one, but it only works if you have a few orchids or one orchid, in case you don't have multiple lamps, obviously. I actually do, because that's how I grow my fowls, but you can actually achieve something very, very similar using your window and natural light if this is how you grow your Phalaenopsis. So here is one example. This is a newer orchid in my collection, but you can see she is starting to have a bias towards this side. She's leaning, she's starting to lean at this point. But the flower spike, the new one, not the old ones, is leaning towards the other direction. Why? Because the light is here. Well, because when I saw the flower spike, I actually rotated the orchid in this manner. Since it's not producing leaves right now, these leaves will not start to turn towards the light. Only the new leaves will start to turn, which is not a look that I like, but now there's no danger of that happening. Therefore, the flower spike has just started to grow towards the light. But this time the light comes from this direction. And this is because I wanted the spike to arise from the back, not to take a shortcut or actually a weird path and arise from here somewhere and lean in this direction. I want the flower spike to be straight and then to create the arch. So again, just by changing the position of the light source, you can determine the spike to go the direction you want. At this point, I think it's enough. You can see the flower spike is really curved. At this point, I can rotate my orchid once again, and now the spike will start to take a turn and start to grow towards the main light once again. Now, when doing this, you have to keep a close eye on the flower spike, because in time, the spike will become rigid, non-flexible, and it will not turn towards the light anymore. The first few centimeters at the top are the flexible ones that move. So if you leave this orchid in this position for a whole month and you have the flower spike like this, and then you try to turn it, you will not obtain a nice arch. You will have a pretty contorted flower spike in most cases. So do keep an eye out on the orchid and rotate it in time for the flower spike to actually take a nice turn. Now with this technique, keep in mind that the flower spike will turn towards the brightest light source. So if you have a window and you also have a lamp, the flower spike will choose in between the two, which is the brightest. And even if you put a lamp on top of the orchid, if you have natural sun coming from the window, the spike will just ignore the lamp and will go towards the sun, because the sun is always stronger than the lamp in most cases. Also, a bright wall. Let me show you an example. In the back there, I have a flower spike just heading towards the wall. Why is this happening? Well, because the distance between the orchid and the wall is smaller than the distance between the orchid and the lamp. And the lamp reflects on the wall, which is white, so the flower spike registers the wall as being the brightest source of light. So in this case, you need to intervene. I will show you how I'm going to intervene in another step in this little tutorial, because at this point the flower spike is still flexible, so I can bring it closer to the light still at this point and start to shape it. So if possible, do try to keep your orchid against a darker wall or maybe even the living room. Try not to have a white wall behind your orchid, because it's just gonna make things a lot harder. We can control the shape of the spike by controlling the light source. So in the beginning, I had my lights right above the orchid, so the flower spike started to grow up. But now I want the flower spike to arch nicely in front of the orchid, so I have a nice little cascade. I can do that by simply moving the light source a little further away and to one side. And this will make the flower spikes actually start to arch and travel towards the light. And this is because this is what I want to obtain. This is my personal preference. There are some orchids which I absolutely love when they have pendant flower spikes, but the spikes are just so much more beautiful if they start from the back of the orchid and arch in front of it. That's what I'm trying to achieve here. But there is another thing you can achieve with flower spikes, and this is the flower cascade. I do have a dedicated video on it. I'll link you to it down below, but I will explain it again kind of today. It implies staking the flower spike straight and then letting it curve under the weight of the flowers. Not all orchids can do this. Only the Phalaenopsis with big, big flowers can have a beautiful, beautiful cascade. Something like the Mini Mark or even the Mini Phalaenopsis, they will not have a very, very long cascade, so I don't bother with them. But with the big flowered phals, sometimes I do like a good cascade, and we're gonna try to do one today. So this is the orchid we saw earlier. The flower spike is heading towards the wall, actually, and I know which orchid is this one. It doesn't create big, big flowers, but it does produce a lot of flowers, even branches. So making a cascade out of this one is possible because the entire efflorescence will be heavy. Usually orchids with non-heavy efflorescences, and by this I mean to the entire amount of the flowers, don't really create beautiful cascades. So if you ever want to attempt this, do go for the orchids with the heaviest, biggest flowers. So for the cascade, we actually need a stake. You can hang on to the orchid stakes throughout the years, but try to use the same stake for the same orchid, just so you don't spread disease in between orchids, or you can purchase new stakes. And I've seen them around in garden centers in my area, even flower shops. You can also buy them online from orchid nurseries. Repot Me has them. I think eBay and Amazon have them as well. They are bamboo stakes. They are already coated, so they will not start to mold, depending on the quality. What we are going to do is try to secure the flower spike and maintain it straight. Because this orchid has heavy flowers, the spike will not remain straight even after it becomes rigid, so a stake is needed. We're going to insert a stake in the medium, and a little tip here, when you insert the stake, don't put it on the side of the pot, because this is where the roots usually circle. Your best bet is to be halfway somewhere if possible. There is always a chance you're gonna touch a root, but on the side of the pot is where you will have most of the roots, and you want to damage as less as possible. If you go here, you might actually not even encounter any roots. So I will be placing the flower stake next to the flower spike, and I'm just gonna see how it will look like. I think I can go here. So you want the stake to be close to the flower spike, but not go through the center of the orchid, obviously. So I think if I put my stake here, it's going to be okay. With Leica, it's not easy to insert a stake, but with other types of media, it will be much easier. So just take your time, make sure that you don't damage the flower spike. And actually, I don't think I hurt any root. I didn't feel any resistance. So in my case, you can see I want the flower spike to not lean towards this way. I want it to be straight. So what I will do now is tie it to the stake. Okay, so at this stage, the flower spike is very tender. This is why I am able to move it around. It is very flexible, but also very sensitive. So for starters, I'm going to use this thread, which is very, very soft. It will not harm or scratch the flower spike in any way. If we're gonna use something like this, there's always the danger of it just pinching way too much the flower spike, creating bruises or even break the flower spike. With thin flower spikes, this can work because imagine you'll have the thickness of the stake and then whatever's left is the room for the flower spike. With thin flower spikes, maybe using something like this from the beginning can work, but this is not a thin flower spike and using this will definitely damage it. We can switch to these after the flower spike hardens and becomes rigid and more powerful. Now though, I will be using some string, which will not be very aesthetic, yes, but at this point we're just shaping it, and when it's gonna be ready, we can just remove it and put whatever clips we want. So first off, I'm going to tie quite loosely at the meeting point, as close to the base as possible. Now, I will not tie it to the point of actually strangling the flower spike. We are just shaping it right now. We don't even need to tug on the threads to make them very, very tight. We just want them to keep the flower spike next to the stake. And then I'm going to cut another one, and this will be something you can move around as the flower spike grows. Let me show you what I mean. So I will be tying another one a little further up and make the flower spike come closer to the stake. Again, this is very loose, loose enough that I can actually move it on the stake. And as the flower spike grows, I think I can make it a little tighter. As the flower spike grows, I can move this little tie up and down. Actually, we will only go up and make sure that it remains straight on the stake. At some point, you might actually need to put another tie somewhere at the bottom because it might start to make a little belly or a little tummy, I don't know how to call it. But in the end, as the flower spike grows, you will be able to move this little tie upwards and maintain the flower spike on the stake. How long should you do this though? Well, as long as the flower spike does not create buds, you can keep straightening it on the stake. And I do have an orchid to exemplify. So here's an orchid with a much taller and more developed flower spike. Let's say I wanted to stake it. I would pin this flower spike, and already this is pretty rigid. I would pin the flower spike to the stake. And you can see I have nodes across the flower spike. These nodes are secondary spikes, but then here at the top, we can see the nodes that will form the buds start to form. And you can recognize them by the distance in between them. Look how much the distance between this node is and this node, and even this node and this node. The distances are pretty big. But in the case of buds, the distances are very, very small. So this will be the first bud of the orchid. We want to secure the flower spike just above the last node, which can produce a branch. We don't want to secure the node which will produce a bud. As this flower spike will grow, it will become heavier and heavier, and it will start to naturally lean under its own weight. We can even help it out with positioning the light somewhere on a more horizontal level than above the flower spike. But typically with big flowered orchids, the flower spike will start to lean. And of course, if this is the last point that you have staked, it will start to lean from here, from the very first flower. And this is how that beautiful cascade will be produced. Now, this is not a big flowered orchid. It does produce quite a lot of flowers and a few branches. I'm not entirely sure if I want to stake it, but because the flower spike is already straight and I only achieved this with light, not with the flower stake, I can postpone staking it. I'll decide later what I want to do with this one. And this is only because of the lamp technique. If you're using the window technique, staking it with an actually hard stake is very necessary because there's just so much light coming from the window, you cannot really control the angle. With the lamp, you can absolutely make it come from here or from here or from here. With the sun, you cannot do that. So obviously, a hard stake will help out. And as a last idea, staking the flower spikes is not mandatory. In most cases, nothing bad will happen if you just let the spike be. But keep in mind, these are hybrids, they're man-made, they are created to produce. So in nature, orchids don't really have issues with very heavy flower spikes breaking due to their heaviness, but in cultivation with these hybrids, there is such a thing. So some orchids do benefit from having a hard stake just to secure the flower spike. It's just a support for the flower spike and for the amount of flowers these orchids can produce. Again, in nature, they would not produce such a thing. This does not exist in nature. So it's another question of how do orchids handle being alone in nature? They don't, because this doesn't exist in nature. Something else exists, which is more adapted to being alone and without help in nature. So as I was saying, not necessary to stake or shape flower spikes. It's more of an aesthetic issue. But sometimes with those very, very big flowered Phalaenopsis, stakes are just supports and they are useful. My personal preference is to just let them go wild. I like to shape the spike to first be straight and then take a turn, and the best solution is the light thing, but of course you can be creative. You know how flower shops have those curved stakes? I've seen them a lot this year. You can absolutely do something like this and tie the flower spike on a curved stake, and it will take the curvature of the stake for Valentine's Day. I usually see them around a lot. So you can actually be creative, just be very gentle with the flower spike. It is very, very tender. As it matures, it becomes more and more rigid and hard to work with. But when it is young and tender, it's very flexible. You can work with it, but just be careful. Now, this is not related to flower spikes necessarily, but to flowers. Guess what else starts to turn towards the light? Buds and flowers as well. When the buds start to form, don't move the orchid or the light source around way too much, because the buds will start to turn each side towards the light, and in the end, the cascade will just not be perfect. It will not be pretty. So if you're looking for that display with all of the flowers facing the same direction, when the buds start to form, don't move the orchid. Find a place for it where it will not be hindered by anything in its development. Let it be there. Don't put it in the darkness. Don't put it in the sun. Maintain bright shade, but don't change the direction of the light source anymore. But again, orchids are surprising, and sometimes there's just that flower which doesn't really have space and it's pointing upwards. That happens as well. What you can do is actually help the bud position itself. If it's caught in between other buds, gently try to remove it from its weird position, and it will position itself afterwards if nothing holds it. Also, if you're using lamps or artificial light, when the flowers start to curve downwards, make sure that the light goes away into one side or quite horizontal to them, because the flowers will start to arrange themselves towards the light again. So the lamp is really great when the spike forms, but afterwards, when the flowers actually open, it's not so great anymore, and you need to find a position further away from the orchid so it gives a more dispersed, more diffused light, or just take the orchid and put it next to the window when the flowers open. And I think that is about it. Alrighty then, thank you so much for watching this video. I hope you've enjoyed it, hope it was useful. If you are trying the technique, tag me on Instagram. By the way, I'm pretty active on Instagram nowadays. Check the link to my account down below in the description. Basically, it's @MissOrchidGirl. And if you are attempting this or you already have displays, tag me in a photo. I would like to see it. And with that said, you know the drill. Like or dislike this video below. Subscribe to my channel for regular orchid videos, tutorials, Q&As, and other fun orchid subjects. And if you like YouTube to notify you whenever I upload a new video, just turn on notifications for my channel. Also, I have links to the products that I use on a regular basis in the description, so just expand it if you're interested in that. And with that said, I'll see you guys next time. Bye!